Hi everyone, welcome to today's research seminar. It's such a pleasure to introduce our guest, Dr. Jeff King. Francois and I have both known Jeff for a number of years, so it's a particular treat to have him come to Osgoode today while he's in town, teaching a course downtown at U of T Law as a distinguished visitor. Jeff, I'm not sure what distinguished...
I question
what separates distinguished visitor from normal visitor at U of T? I'm just not sure. Do you get a badge or...?
No badge.
Jeff is a senior lecturer at University College London. He previously held academic posts at University of Oxford, which is where he also completed his doctorate. His research interests include comparative constitutional and admin law, international human rights, sociolegal studies, and legal and political theory. His talk today is going to draw from his new book, hot off the presses from Cambridge University Press, titled Judging Social Rights. And in this monograph, he offers an extended argument on why economic and social rights should be constitutionalized and subject to judicial interpretation and enforcement. So please join me in welcoming Jeff King.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Aaron, for that very kind introduction, and to Aaron and Francois for inviting me here to give this talk. It's a real pleasure to come from the UK back home so that I can talk about these things. And the ideas of the book really do apply to Canada and the UK and similar Commonwealth countries, and I'll explain that in a moment. I'll pass around the book in case you wanted to flip through it a bit during the talk. It's annotated a bit. That's where I made all the mistakes that I've been noting down. So don't pay too much attention to the annotations, please. So the book, as Aaron said, presents an argument for constitutionalizing social rights in countries like the UK, and I think Canada's like the UK in the relevant respects, and a theory of adjudication that I recommend that judges use to enforce these rights. So I'm concerned with presenting the case for social rights and to elaborate on a way for judges to adjudicate hard cases under such a constitution. And it's best, I think, to consider this proposal by considering a few typical hard cases that judges might have to work their way through. So let me start with the Rogers case. Also, we could call it the Herceptin case. Anne-Marie Rogers had late-stage breast cancer. Herceptin was a new drug on the market, which had not yet received cost-effectiveness approval from the regulatory agency, NICE, the National Institute on Clinical Health and Excellence. The local authority had a policy of funding drugs for early-stage breast cancer, but only of funding drugs for late-stage breast cancer in exceptional cases. Now, the issue in this case was whether the right to life gave Anne-Marie Rogers a right to that medicine. She asked the court to enforce such a right. Now, ordinarily, administrative law stays far away from these types of decisions, but here, Rogers invoked the European Convention. And the court was thus prepared to take a closer look at the decision. It found in that case that the local health authority could maintain a policy of only funding in exceptional cases, but it had to have an idea of what an exceptional case would be, and it didn't, so it quashed the decision. I thought that judgment was right. The second case is Shaoli, which many of you probably know about. So as you know, Canada has a policy, or has had a policy, of banning private medical insurance contracts. The aim is, of course, to force everyone into a one-tier state-paid system of delivering medical services. The idea of this system is that it would strengthen the system by creating general political support for the state system. But there's a problem with wait times, as you well know, and a claimant patient, an enterprising doctor, argued that these wait times interfered with the patient's right under Section 7 of the Charter in a way that wasn't justified. Now, 4 of 7 judges accepted that argument and ordered the province to remove the ban on private medical insurance contracts or make the wait times reasonable. And when they did this, they reviewed a tremendous amount of evidence, social science evidence, about how two-tier healthcare systems operate in other countries. Despite the testimony of government experts, the court decided that there was no evidence that a two-tier medical system would imperil the national healthcare system. It thus essentially required Quebec to remove its ban on private medical insurance. One scholar, Sujit Chowdhury, wrote an article about this case asking the question, is it worse than Lochner? The third case, well, I think many of us agree that that case was a bad one. And we have a fear that if we have constitutional social rights, we'll have more Shaoli-type cases. The third case is one from South Africa. It's called the Treatment Action Campaign, and it arose during the HIV crisis there. The case was decided in 2002. It was about a new drug called nevirapine, which helped reduce mother-to-child transmission of HIV. And the government in South Africa said that there were questions over the drug's safety, so that it could only be rolled out in a very slow, incremental basis, and it had to be bundled into a more comprehensive package of treatment. So in other words, it forbade doctors to prescribe the drug where it seemed to be medically indicated. And its reasons were concern over safety. Now, the important special fact in the case is that there was no strong evidence that this safety concern was well-founded. In fact, the General Medicines Council in South Africa was unanimous in believing that these safety concerns were unfounded, as was the World Health Organization. So the evidence was against the government. The Constitutional Court quashed the decision and ordered the government to make the drug available. And these are the kinds of cases that exemplify the tough ones that come up in adjudication, both the good, and I consider the last one, Treatment Action Campaign, and the first one, Rogers, to be good cases, and bad cases, like the one, like Shaoli. That Shaoli could have come up under the assertion of a right to health. Now, the point of any theory of social rights adjudication should be to offer a roadmap for adjudication that helps judges navigate their way away from the bad and towards the good, and which is also readable and understandable by ordinary judges. In other words, it's not too refined or complex. Now, that's the point of this book, Judging Social Rights. So I carry out that project in three parts in the book. And the first is the case for social rights. And it's here that I explain why I think social rights are important enough to be considered human and constitutional rights, and why we ought to be cautiously optimistic that protecting them in the Constitution would be a worthwhile form of protection. But I also conclude in part one that due to the complexity of the welfare state, it is very important that we have a workable theory of judicial restraint, a kind of theory that would steer us away from outcomes like Shaoli. So the case for social rights depends on having a workable theory of judicial restraint. Part two of the book offers this theory. And in a nutshell, I conclude that judges should give significant weight to four key principles of restraint: democratic legitimacy, polycentricity, expertise, and the need for administrative and legislative flexibility. Now, each of these principles is important because, at first, each of these principles, each of these ideas, seem to be a fatal objection to constitutionalizing social rights. The bulk of the book is devoted to showing why they are not fatal objections. They don't justify rejecting social rights, but they do justify a measure of judicial restraint. In rebutting these objections, I recast the concerns, expertise, polycentricity, and so on, into principles of restraint. And that's the main bulk of the book, centerpiece of it, really. Part three is really just one chapter. And it's here that the theory meets reality, because if you look at part two of the book, you'll see it's quite long. Each chapter dealing with these principles is lengthy, and there's a lot said about what is good and what is bad for judges to be doing when, for instance, reviewing polycentric questions or expertise. The point of chapter three is to offer a heuristic, in other words, to offer a tool that judges can use to arrive at the kinds of outcomes that generally comport with the principles of restraint. And that heuristic is the idea of judicial incrementalism. I say this is a workable approach that judges can take. It will normally guide us to the right answers. And it's in that chapter, that final chapter, that I address the tough questions about whether incrementalism is too little, whether it's too much, or it's too unrealistic to expect judges to follow it. So let me dive into the first part in some detail. So let's think for a moment about what the importance of social rights is, social rights as human rights. Now, I argue in chapter two of the book that we have a human right to a social minimum, that we have an interest, an important human interest, in having a social minimum, and that states are under a range of duties to secure that minimum to us. So one question is, of course, what values found this type of claim, that people have duties, other people and the state have duties to respect or provide even our social minimum? Well, there are a number of candidates. Dignity, a minimum conditions required for a dignified life, tend to be at the base of many theories of human rights. Autonomy, you might think that the capacity to form, revise, and to have the opportunity to act out a life plan is what founds our human rights. Many people take that view. James Griffin, most notably in a recent book. Or you might think that deliberation and civic participation, if you're a civic Republican, for instance, you're attracted to Philip Pettit's ideas, are the supremely important political values that make political outcomes democratic. Well, if you think that, then you must recognize that a social minimum is quite essential for civic participation and adequate deliberation. Or maybe you think well-being or utility is the important value, and there too you can easily offer a utilitarian justification of the kinds of protections in the welfare state that social rights require. So philosophy will recognize human social rights, but the question for us as lawyers is whether constitutionalization is a good institutional means for securing the social minimum or ensuring that public decision making in respect of these interests is adequate. So the key question really that I'm tackling in the book is institutional. Should we legalize? Now let's observe for a moment that this question is straightforwardly instrumentalist. Would legalization help promote an outcome, that is, respect for the social minimum? Because that's the question, the answer is necessarily jurisdiction specific. It might do it in some places and it might not in others. That's why I limit my argument to countries that have similar background political conditions to the UK. So what are some of those conditions? A good faith political commitment to the welfare state, reasonably independent courts, a well-functioning civil service, and an attitude of respect and cooperation among branches of government, which I call interinstitutional collaboration, which is, I admit, an unfortunate phrase. Now, these conditions are present in Canada, in the UK, Australia, New Zealand, and I think in a range of countries in Northern Europe. But they're not reliably present in the United States. So I make no claims about whether social rights are appropriate for that country or whether judicial restraint is the appropriate mode of adjudication when they do adopt social rights. And you'll be surprised to learn that the US state courts have been enforcing state constitutional rights to education in particular in ways that would be baffling, in forms of structural and injunctive relief that are exactly like the desegregation cases that were coming about in the 70s and 80s. So why should courts, you might ask, I expected this question at this law school in particular, why should we think courts should have anything to offer in this enterprise? Well, in a way, that's a bit like saying, why should we have administrative law, or why should we have freedom of information, or why should we have the rule of law? They're hard questions to answer. But here is a first crack at offering some idea of what I think makes legal accountability valuable as a public type of decision making. And this is an account for the value of legal accountability all over the shop, I think. One is that it involves focus on particular issues and cases, and it presents the court with real narratives for diagnosing problems. A second is that it offers a form of principled reasoning, which is beneficial for evidence assessment. It's beneficial because it offers transparent procedures and gives people input. And it also requires a certain measure of principled consistency, not just between precedents. That can be of dubious value, in fact. But I mean, it can require the government, in offering an explanation, to be consistent, or else having the argument fall in the kind of light that's shed by adjudication. Judges, of course, offer a modicum of independence from party ideology. That's the most frequent argument for judicial review. And the process can offer avenues of participation for marginalized groups. Fifthly, and lastly, I think here, judicial review, legal accountability generally, offers a special type of constitutional authority that can force the government to explain itself, to listen, and to carry out certain remedies. That constitutional authority is a valuable feature of courts. It's why we like to use judges, for instance, for important public inquiries. My main claim is that public decision making about some issues, and especially rights issues, benefits greatly from these types of institutional features. I've given five. In fact, I think there are 10. I list them in the book, but I also have a separate paper called The Instrumental Value of Legal Accountability, where I defend these claims against the more obvious objections, and there are some very good objections. So much for a very general, and I admit, abstract case for legal accountability. We have to acknowledge at this stage that there are two very good reasons to be cautious about this project, about inviting judges to walk into the welfare state and start rearranging things. The first is because of the remarkable complexity of the welfare state. So consider at the legislative level how complex some of these statutes are. In Britain, for instance, the Housing Act of 1996 consists of 232 sections, 12 schedules, and it's been subject to over 500 amendments since 1996. And that statute only really codifies a century of developing law on the obligations of local authorities to house the homeless and so on. In social security law, it's worse. There are about 57 primary statutes and over 1,000 statutory instruments, regulations, and so on. And of course, in Parliament, you have a tremendous number of committees that are meeting very regularly and adopting reports on all aspects of the welfare state. And that's not even to mention the power of the purse, which if you know anything about parliamentary procedure, you'll know that that's an incredibly touchy area and an important area that must be understood and respected before judges start imposing onerous obligations. At the executive level, this complexity is no less of an issue. So creating policy for drug funding or health and safety or running hospitals for a population of 30-something million is an administrative, legislative, commercial, and humanitarian operation of mind-boggling proportions. So complexity means judges have to be cautious. But the second reason to be cautious is, in fact, there's already a very substantial involvement of adjudication in the welfare state. So we may have a reporter about civil liberties or about the Canadian Charter, I'm not quite sure. But in the UK, which I can speak to, there are the housing law reports, the community care law reports, which concern social care, medico-legal reports, mental health law reports, education law reports. The list goes on. These areas, these reports are full of cases that interpret these complex webs of statutes. And the adjudication itself is complex. So in the tribunals in the UK, in 1 year, they disposed in Social Security alone of 280,000 cases, 70% of them after formal hearing and ruling. In that same year, the administrative court disposed of less than 500 substantive judicial review applications. So we need an approach, in other words, that is sensitive to this complexity and that is compatible with and builds on this already pre-existing involvement of adjudicative institutions in the welfare state. So let me get around then to my main positive proposal, the idea of what I think courts should do, before I get around to looking more at what they shouldn't do, which is violate these principles of restraint. So what is the most basic idea of the interpretive approach I'm offering? It's this. I think that the role of the court in enforcing a Bill of Constitutional Social Rights is to promote and ensure reasonableness, fairness, and participation in public decision-making about social welfare rights. The normative importance of social rights is the trigger that calls into play this special mode of accountability. It justifies the recourse to judicial review. So in my view, the Constitution is a signal that there's a special gravity in presumptive importance to these welfare interests. Anyone who's deprived of these interests can call the court's attention to the matter and force the government to justify its decision in a rigorous fashion. When it does that, the court should be preoccupied with testing the adequacy of the justification or the reasoning underlying the public action or omission, the plausibility of premises, the validity of inferences, and so on. And ultimately, the compatibility of this policy with any dense, let's say, conceptual core of the right. So the court would give a certain presumptive weight to the interest. Some features of this approach. The role of the court is not to say what the social minimum is, what you need as structural features of housing, for instance, or what a suitable education is. Some courts have done this in the US and in Brazil. And it has not been an unequivocal success. In fact, in Brazil, it's been something of a disaster. Secondly, the approach builds on the existing framework of the welfare state. In many ways, it's parasitic upon the existing structures. That doesn't mean it's inert. One can make claims about the inadequacy of a program, say that inaction itself is unreasonable, given the constitutional commitment to social rights. But the judicial action that is taken is guided by this complex framework and respects the pre-existing system of mutual expectations that's built around it. You might wonder, is this any different, really, than administrative law? Is it administrative law on steroids? It is different, in my view, although the similarities are very strong. You can consider whether charter review here in Canada, which normally comes down to how the proportionality question is answered, is any different to administrative law review, necessity and reasonableness. There's a debate in Britain right now about whether these are conceptually different from each other. But we do know that the courts are much more searching under charter review than they are under administrative law review. The words look the same, but the Bill of Constitutional Rights gives a special green light to courts to give presumptive importance and weight to the interest. It reinforces their mandate to be more searching for justifications in this area. Also under this model, and this is more important, the courts are not restricted to looking at executive action, but can look at legislative action and the process that leads up to it. And that's a real difference. So that's the basic idea. I don't call it a reasonableness approach, but it could safely be called, I think, a reasonableness approach. That takes me to part two. And I want to look at the cases that I mentioned at the beginning and explain why I think they were rightly or wrongly decided. So in this part, as I said, I outline four principles that I think are typically offered as objections to social rights. And I say that they don't justify the idea of the non-justiciability of social rights. The first objection is the one that courts have no democratic legitimacy at enforcing these rights. Now, I reply at length to Jeremy Waldron's compelling objection to judicial review. And his argument is basically that allowing judges to set aside statutes, any statutes, he argues, is to renounce our claim to equal influence in the decision-making process. It renounces our right to participate in public decision-making. And he says our right to participate is at issue just as much when it comes to defining our rights as it is when we define other policies. Now, the best answer, in my view, to this line of critique is that, in fact, the formal equality that Waldron is talking about in a legislature is to an important extent illusory. Marginalized groups, the poor chief among them, do not actually have influence. Many don't even vote. Fine, this is familiar territory. But notice something important here. This only makes the case for judicial review for those people who are marginalized groups. So consider our examples again. In Shaoli, was the patient marginalized? And was the doctor seeking to open a private medical business marginalized? Hardly. They're as Joe and Jane Blow as you get. And I have to say, on a more unfortunate note, it's probably the case that women at risk of late-stage breast cancer are also not marginalized in the political process. This didn't come up in the Herceptin case, and I know we could have a discussion about this, but I think if your risk, I think the risk factor is something like 1 in 8 or 1 in 10 women, at least in Britain, I think it's that, is at risk of this. And so it has a very high profile politically. In the Herceptin case, actually the minister did intervene in the case, but it was executive action, so the issue didn't come up. If it were a constitutional challenge, I'm afraid my theory, which says that we should use judicial review to protect marginalized groups and not the middle classes or the wealthy, would have given cold comfort to the claimant. Consider Treatment Action Campaign. Well, that is a quintessential example of a marginalized group. The government had a policy of AIDS denialism, and for that reason, democratic legitimacy would be a poor justification for deferring to the legislative branch in that case. Now, there's another aspect of the democratic legitimacy argument, of Waldron's argument, and it's that it presupposes that the legislature is actually focused on the issue and discussed it and voted on it. And of course, we know that that's not actually always the case. I've looked at the Human Rights Act in the UK, and out of 19 declarations of incompatibility, about 6 or 7 were on issues where the legislature never properly focused on the issue, or they focused on it in the 19th century. So this, I try to offer an approach that would focus adjudication on protecting those groups that are particularly vulnerable to majoritarian bias or neglect, or to issue remedies that could force the legislature to contend with the issue. Take the second principle, which is polycentricity. And this is a characteristic of certain problems or issues. It is set forth in a paper by Lon Fuller called The Forms and Limits of Adjudication, published in the Harvard Law Review in 1978. Now, he said that a polycentric problem is one that's multifaceted. It implies a network of interconnected relationships. It's like a social program, so that if you change one of the relationships, you change all the others. We need an example, clearly. And one is of a polycentric problem is the idea of setting wages in an industry. The price of wages for workers can affect production costs, can in turn affect advertising, supply chain, and if the industry collapses, it can even have a deflationary effect on the broader market. So that one relationship between workers and management on the question of wages is in fact connected to a broad range of other relationships. That is a polycentric problem. And the problem with tinkering with any polycentric issue is that you can affect a large number of individuals. Access to healthcare, for example, in this country affects literally everyone, now and well into the future as well. And that's a lot of interested parties. Now, Lon Fuller said that polycentric issues are not suitable for judicial review. And some other people, like Michael Polanyi, were libertarians, or Friedrich Hayek, also liked this idea of polycentricity because they didn't like government managing markets. Fuller was not a libertarian, but he did have a view about adjudication and what it's for. And he said that the distinguishing feature of adjudication is that it gives the party affected by the judgment a means of participating in the judgment by presenting proofs and reasons to the court. The problem, as you might have deduced already, is that with polycentric problems, the interested parties don't get to present information to the court. In fact, we might not even know who the affected parties really are. Fuller said that when judges are asked to adjudicate these issues on the basis of limited information, they give judgments that produce unintended consequences. They end up having to try unorthodox solutions, like consulting non-represented parties, ask people what's going to happen if I give a judgment requiring you to fund this drug, off the record, usually. Or they may appoint experts to help them to resolve the big problem. Now, this idea of polycentricity and the critique, you could call it complexity. There's a huge overlap between these ideas. It's potent critique, but the idea of polycentricity is trotted out by scholars against social rights, but left at bay with respect to the rest of adjudication. It's been pointed out many times that polycentricity is actually a pervasive feature of adjudication. We see it in many areas of the law. In fact, every leading case is quite polycentric. So we can't say that polycentric issues are non-justiciable. But what we can usefully say is that we can preserve this idea while admitting some of its exceptions, is that there are special considerations or factors which may justify courts adjudicating polycentric issues that may attenuate the weight that we give to the polycentric character of a legal issue. So one would be, for instance, where the legal regime gives the judge a clear mandate to resolve the problem. So consider the mandate of the European Court of Justice. It adjudicates issues that affect all of Europe in the areas of economic and social relations. You could say that's incredibly polycentric. But the authors of this regime have decided, well, we need to have these kinds of issues disputed or adjudicated at the Court of Justice if we want to have the benefits of this customs union in the European Union. We make similar judgments about, for instance, having questions of the fairness of dismissal come up in employment law, or of the appropriateness of mergers in competition law. We've decided that it's polycentric, but you know what? We'll do it anyway because it's worth it. Another one of these factors that attenuate the weight you give to polycentricity is the idea of degree. How polycentric is it? And another would be, what type of remedy are you proposing to give? To what extent will you be bound by precedent if things don't turn out well in the future? Now, if we consider the cases that I've mentioned, then you can see that in Shaoli, in the healthcare case, the issue was radically polycentric. It affected every Canadian now and all those through the future as well. So even if one was minded to say that the one-tier system did risk the right to personal security of some, we can find other types of remedies for this. So the dissenting judges said, for instance, that we could just adjudicate cases on a case-by-case basis if it turns out that their access to security of the person has been interfered with by this regime. In other words, instead of striking down the possibility of a one-tier medical care system, you would leave it up the option of claimants saying, in this particular case, your policy has made me wait for too long. That would have been a more limited remedy. It would have been radically less polycentric. The cases of Rogers on the Herceptin and the TAC case in South Africa were not polycentric. One of them concerned one person, and there was no issue of scarcity. And the other, there was no issue of scarcity because the drug company was offering the drugs for free. Polycentricity simply didn't arise in that case. So let me move on to the third, and I think for today, the final principle that I'll discuss from part two of the book, and it's the idea of expertise. So this is a very potent objection to social rights adjudication because it is a common one, and it's the idea that how can judges possibly second guess a health authority or a housing office? Now, the importance of this idea is that expertise was used in the past to justify a strong measure of judicial deference during the progressive era in post-war America and Britain, precisely so that courts would back off and let the administrative state, the welfare state, grow. So it's very important to give weight to this idea. Does it justify total restraint? I don't think so. We have to recognize the idea that there will be, in some cases, a trade-off between expertise and accountability. Much of judicial review in the area of public law and regulation functions in an environment where the judge's knowledge of the field is weaker than the government body that's being reviewed. So that's true in the areas of asylum, in competition law, tax affairs, most of judicial review, probably most of criminal procedure as well. We accept a partial trade-off between expertise and accountability because we recognize that unaccountable administration is a social evil that requires correction. And when we probe deeper into the idea of expertise, furthermore, we'll recognize that there are different kinds of expertise and different kinds of trade-offs. So you'll have the frontline expertise of a social worker, for instance, is quite different from the managerial expertise of a minister or agency head. That itself is different from the professional expertise of a doctor. And one doctor's professional expertise is different than the collective professional expertise of an entire agency. What I try to do in the book is go through these different types of expertise and show that each is liable to different kinds of weaknesses and each has different kinds of assets in a way that I think judges can acknowledge. The type of expertise that I say most clearly calls for deference is collective professional expertise. There's also, when looking at arguments based on expertise, the problem of failures of expertise. So we can see lines of cases, for instance, where the administration has not based its opinion on the expertise made available to the government by its own advisors. Or there may be a distinctive fact in the record that just jumps off the page and shows that the claim to expertise is effectively opportunistic. Or, in some cases, it might be that the established social science evidence that has been uncontradicted shows that the claim to expertise is false. And that's what was the case in TAC, in the Treatment Action Campaign. Here, there was a failure to apply the expertise. There was a direct contradiction of the nearly unanimous opinion of the Medicines Council and the WHO. So the expertise argument in Treatment Action falls flat. In Shaolin, by contrast, there was an enormous amount of disagreement between experts on what would happen if we abandoned the one-tier medical system. There, it would have been appropriate to defer to the expertise. What I try to do in the chapter is to offer a test that could be applied that would prevent an outcome like Shaolin and allow an outcome like TAC. That test, I think, is thought by some to be conservative because I basically argue that it should be there must be substantial uniformity of opinion in the relevant scientific community that the proposition at issue is false. And that can be a high bar to clear. Okay, There you have three principles and an explanation of how I think they apply to these cases. And you can see that each of these chapters, and I've given you a very brief summary, involves some fairly refined conceptual distinctions or distinctions that judges would have to apply, and it would raise the risk that they might come to different conclusions, or it raises the risk that they just wouldn't have the patience to try to work through something like this. It might be too exotic, in other words, take too much time. As Wilde said about socialism, it's a nice idea, but it will take too many evenings. That may be the case here too. And that's why the final chapter offers the heuristic, the default tool of incrementalism. So incrementalism is basically a shortcut to the types of answers that the theory of judicial restraint I just outlined normally recommends. So what is this idea? I've taken it from public administration, from an essay by Charles Lindblom called The Science of Muddling Through. And the chief advantage of incrementalism is epistemic. You proceed in small steps, you consider new information, you do that before you proceed anew. The common law method has often been said to be incremental. That's not always true in constitutional adjudication. So the general theme of incrementalism is this: when judges adjudicate vague constitutional social rights under conditions of uncertainty, they should, one, avoid significant nationwide allocative impact, that is, impact on the budgets, and two, either give decisions on narrow, particularized grounds, focusing on the features of the dispute before them, or when they're adjudicating broader macro-level disputes that have significant implications for large numbers of people, they decide in a manner that preserves flexibility. So proceed in small steps, informed by past steps, and when affecting large groups, preserve latitude for adaptation. That's the basic idea. What are the techniques for this kind of thing? Familiar ones, I'd say. So particularizing, using analogical reasoning, procedural rights, those are some of the more obvious ones. Less obvious ones are using vague legal standards. So desegregate with all deliberate speed would be a perfect example of a vague obligation that actually gives administration a lot of latitude. Clear majority on a clear question is an example of a vague norm that leaves a lot of latitude. These have virtues. They allow us to adjust in the future to unforeseen circumstances. Constitutional avoidance: decide the case under administrative law if it's available. Why? Because the legislature can change, it can roll back from the decision if it turns out to be dysfunctional in some way. And last, I think the courts, I call it the technique of revisitation. I think the doctrine of precedent should not be enforced strongly in these cases. I think that the judges should be prepared, when the facts on the ground change, to revisit their findings and change their findings as well. I'm not going to discuss now, but I'm happy to do so in the discussion after, how this fits with the ideas of Cass Sunstein on minimalism, and with Michael Dorff and Charles Sable on democratic experimentalism. These two ideas are related. I call them cousins, but I think they're different in important ways to what I'm arguing. Just a couple of criticisms of incrementalism, and I'll close out with these before I give you a summary. So is incrementalism too conservative? Is it inert? And this is related to the following question about the whole book. So what? Well, first of all, judicial restraint doesn't equal administrative restraint. So judges refusing to adjudicate an issue doesn't mean that the state is not going to handle it. That was the essential insight during the Lochner era in the United States. But is judicial restraint itself too inert? Are we underselling the potential of courts by adopting an incrementalist posture? I don't think so. I think that there will be slow growth under conditions where the relevant actors can adjust to new circumstances. And I would even go farther to offer a bit of alchemy here, trying to turn lead into gold. I think that the slow pace of change is actually an advantage, It allows judges to manage the competency concerns I've mentioned above and adjust their doctrines when new information shows some decision to have created problems. Does it offer false promise? Only to the uninformed, I'd say. But what about insidious incrementalism? Would this doctrine permit general inflation? Would a lot of local incrementalism amount to a large change? This has occurred in Brazil. It is an actual real concern, but there's no doctrine of precedent in Brazil. And I'm fairly confident that judges in the UK and Canada, and the rest of these Commonwealth countries, would in fact control this type of inflation. They may even control it too much. Last objection, is it impossible? Will judges actually conform to this idea? Do we expect judges to have this book on their desk? And if the answer is obviously not, then aren't you saying that your case for social rights depends on them doing this and we have no reason to think that they're going to do it? Well, first, it's a bit of a matter of trust. I think incrementalism is already largely reflected in adjudication. I think that judges will proceed cautiously. That's how they've done it in South Africa. I don't think we have any reason to think that judges in Canada and Australia and Britain are going to fling open the doors to the Treasury and say, run in and take what you can. But if we are really concerned about that, we can make it a matter of constitutional text. We can actually put principles of interpretation into the Constitution that more or less direct judges towards taking an incrementalist approach. So let me conclude just by recapping a few of the key points I've made in this presentation. First is that social rights, in my view, are fundamental human rights. And they deserve strong institutional protection. Second, constitutions are one good way, I think, to protect them. Constitutionalization can generate different kinds of benefits. Some are expressive, some are political, and some are remedial by founding actions in the courts and other institutions. Third, any role for judicial enforcement has to give weight to the principles of legitimacy and competency. We should be reasonably able to say in advance what kinds of outcomes are likely to result. The four principles I've offered, I hope, help to meet that requirement. And I think the heuristic of incrementalism helps to ensure that the default position taken by judges is a defensible one. And that's it. Thank you very much for listening.
So thank you very much, Jeff, for a set of very thoughtful and sophisticated comments. So we're going to open the floor to questions now. Perhaps I'll start by asking, you've presented a normative argument in favor of incrementalism, and you've also suggested your belief that judges would act in that manner. Mm-hmm. I wonder then, if I was a policymaker sitting here, if I might say on the second tier, Jeff, I disagree with you, and the closest analog is the international sphere, and I've seen what the Committee on Economic and Social Rights have done and how activists they've been, and that's a reason why, one of the reasons why we haven't transformed our economic and social rights obligations from the international sphere into our domestic law.
Yes, that's a very valid point, and that's why I'm very concerned with what the international committees have been doing. I don't think, though, that the international committees are analogous to domestic courts, largely because they're typically staffed with people who regard themselves as social rights advocates and experts in that particular field, and also because the UN committee in particular is engaged in what's called a constructive dialogue with states on these kinds of issues. It knows the states do have a certain latitude in just ignoring what they say. So I think that different institutional reality means that the committee, let's say, overplays its hand very often. I think if they knew that the state would have to implement these judgments, if they were to be taken as seriously as a national court's order, their doctrine would change quickly. So, but you could also point to the case of India, which has taken public interest litigation very far as other evidence that the courts might go too far. My general claims on that is that India is really in a case of its own due to the way that the institutions are arranged there. I think Commonwealth courts would almost certainly go in the direction of South Africa, and the evidence there is that they've proceeded quite incrementally.
Okay, thank you. Questions from the audience, please. Francois?
So just ask a few questions. There are two microphones. Make sure you get one of them before you ask your question so that you are on the video. Jeff, quick question. What do you mean by constitutionalization? What I understand you as meaning is you want a strong judicial review, written norm, kind of entrenched. But then at some point in your talk, you say, well, if you can do it through administrative law, go there, because that will give you a lot more flexibility if, in case the experiment that results from the ruling is not as successful as it ought to be. So aren't you saying, well, actually, this is not really what I'm advocating, right? The first option should be administrative law. What about the UK situation? That's another alternative to say declaration of incompatibility with perhaps a lot of guidance from the court, mm-hmm. which involves a legislature and creates a much stronger dialogical model than we might have, say, in Canada or worse in the US, right? So even though you're not talking about the US.
Thank you, Francois. So the first question about constitutional avoidance is a very fair one. So if I'm saying show preference for administrative law, why should we have constitutionalization at all? Because constitutionalization gives a set of remedies that are not available in administrative law.
Such as?
Well, such as the power to strike down legislation.
Okay.
Is the most important one, I'd say. The power to order more elaborate remedies, for instance. Some mandatory or structural relief is extremely rare in administrative law. I mean, a mandatory relief that is more than bring the prisoner over to this, you know, something like revise your program or something like that. So the preference for administrative law takes place in the context of there being a constitutional norm in the background. So in the Herceptin case, for instance, it was actually decided under administrative law. They said the decision to have a policy of exceptionality without knowing what an exceptional case would be is irrational. But it was the fact that there was a right to life in play that said we have a stronger standard of substantive review in administrative law. Yeah. And that made a big difference in that case. And I thought that's a model for how we would do this. So you might use the Constitution as a background norm to give welfare-friendly readings to Social Security statutes.
Because you could say in the context of administrative law, you ought to have high scrutiny for human rights, period. And that
yes. does,
you don't need the constitutional norms. We already do this, right, in the human rights tribunal. And at the level of the remedies, you could say, well, actually, even the courts in the context of civil and political rights that have strong constitutional review will be very reluctant to monitor their remedies, to go beyond the simple striking down, right? In Canada, you had to wait till Doucet Boudreau. The US had it before us.
Yes.
This is a new development for us.
Yes, it is. It is. And I actually argue in the book that we should avoid structural relief.
Okay.
I would have been in the dissent in Doucet Boudreau, for instance. I think they were right, actually. They were prepared to say we need it, but they said we don't have the evidence yet. Doucet Boudreau was a Section 21 educational rights for members of linguistic minorities in New Brunswick, was it?
Nova Scotia.
And they said the judge retained jurisdiction of the case and essentially created structural injunctive relief, which is fairly new in Canada. The minority of the Supreme Court said the judge shouldn't have done that. They should have issued a declaration. And if that didn't work, then there could have been further remedies. I agreed with that judgment, frankly. So I think can you do it all with admin law? No, I think it makes the mandate more robust, and I think it allows you to challenge legislative action. And those are two differences that we've seen. The UK situation, why not have declarations of incompatibility? Depends on your state. In the UK, I would advocate that approach for social rights too.
Okay.
Because it actually works. They don't typically ignore these declarations. It's a bit like, ignoring one is a bit like using Section 33. But the advantage of the UK system is that Parliament has to debate the issue every time. And I think there are advantages for that. I think it's good to engage the civic capacities of parliamentarians by making them debate rights issues. It sounds a bit pie in the sky, but I'm actually reading all of the Hansard for all of these debates right now. There's only been 19 of them. And some of it is quite encouraging. There are a lot more rights advocates in Parliament, in the British Parliament, than you might think.
You should read the Calder decision before you make any ruling about Canada.
Okay.
Well, on that too, one of the preconditions is a commitment to the... One of your preconditions is a commitment to the social welfare state. I mean, does anyone want to challenge Jeff on how committed Canada actually is to the social welfare state?
Sorry.
I have a different kind of question. I'm not going to answer your, I'm not going to challenge on it. I think that you could probably read any newspaper and get your challenge from there. But, okay, I understand your project is really about helping or maybe reassuring judges and policymakers that constitutionalizing these rights might not necessarily be revolutionary. But I think my question is a little bit outside that scope, but you obviously are going to be able to answer it. And it's really about since you've raised all this in the healthcare context, one of the things that is really obvious is the way that rationing can come into this. Mm. Right? And what that raises for me is questions about access to justice and the ways in which those cases which make it to the court are probably only a small subset of the potentially successful cases, but the way that court decisions engage in the form of rationing that we typically a lot to governments, and just a question about how you could answer questions that are really about the court system in general, but might have a particular heft in the context of social rights where access to justice itself is obviously going to be a significant concern.
Yes. So that is, let me, I think you chose rationing as a very paradigmatic example of how by letting courts interfere with the process, you're allowing those who go to the court to aggregate resources to themselves. But that point applies to the whole spectrum of social welfare rights. So on the issue of rationing itself, I think the court should show very strong restraint. Okay, so but that's only a partial answer to your objection, because it applies to the others. And this is related to whether courts are a hollow hope and whether they're a hollow hope for the poor in particular. So if we look, I haven't gone through the statistics in Canada, but the view that courts are a hollow hope for the poor is actually to an important extent misguided. So in Britain, for instance, most judicial review cases against the government are legally aided. That means they're in the bottom third of the income stream. And I've looked, the statistics are in the book, actually. It's also a paper by Herb Kritzer, who's an important law and politics scholar, showing that income actually is, he says it has relatively little to do with whether people actually consult a lawyer. He's been challenged on that point, but he presents evidence to show that the received wisdom about this point is actually in need of serious revisitation. Hazel Genn's Paths to Justice also shows that the poor have much more access to courts if your legal aid system is in good working order than people think. Now, the problem is that in Britain, the legal aid system is extremely good. I don't know how it is here, but if we look at the charter cases, and I got a tough question from David Schneiderman the other day, which I didn't answer well, about why I was so confident that courts would help these people. And he said that that's not what's happened in the Canadian Charter. So I did a bit of homework last night, and I looked at the top 10 charter cases that constitutional scholars agreed were the most important. Most of them had to do with the rights of prisoners, in fact. Some had to do with the rights of people who had been discriminated against. So I think the claim that the courts, when they're given rights adjudication, are necessarily focused on the middle classes and the wealthy is not borne out by the evidence.
Yeah, and that would be a really interesting conversation to have. But I don't think, I mean, that's a secondary issue about how the courts have actually adjudicated the claims they have received, and that some of the very prominent ones I would say probably suggest that in terms of access to services, yes, there are some quite promising cases. On the other hand, in terms of alleviation of poverty in general, no, there aren't.
Well, the charter isn't a mandate to do that.
Arguably.
Well, exactly. The social rights advocacy is a big thing for me.
Yeah.
I actually say, no, I don't think you can leverage a complete protection of social rights out of the Canadian Charter.
But I think what I'm thinking about is much more about pre-adjudication. So your points about are about getting to the adjudication stage. Mm-hmm. So I think your comments about legal aid are the significant ones. And I suppose in Canada, the concern comes out of problems in the legal aid system, but maybe more specifically because many of these significant cases are test case type cases. cases, the lack of support for large case development, which given the way that cases like Shelley are actually litigated, there's a significant amount of, on your expertise point, there's a huge amount of litigation material that has to be produced. Mm. So that these kinds of cases are very complicated and expensive to run, and so they're either done pro bono or they've got to have some kind of funding behind them. So, but I know you've worked with Bruce, you obviously know that. So I think my question is really, maybe your answer is you don't anticipate this happening on such a large scale, right? That some of the benefit of this is that a small number of cases will produce an effect across a much broader set of potential claims, which will never have to come to court because of the kind of dialogue and that kind of thing. Maybe that's one answer.
That is part of the, because I think these kinds of cases probably will be and ought to be fairly rare. We don't want the courts restructuring the welfare state every day. That's probably one of the main messages of the book. We do want people invoking their social rights when they're trying to say, you've just cut my pension by 30% and on some specious argument, and this is really important. So I do think that for the bigger cases, that heavy, onerous amount of participation by interveners is required and justified. But I don't think, that's not the only benefit, I think, is what I'm trying to say, that this would offer.
Okay, great. Dan?
Danny?
Thanks. Very, very interesting and lots of thoughts. So, I'll start with the kind of empirical comment, which I've not made myself. So my former colleague, Octavio Ferraz, he studied social and economic rights in Brazil, and his conclusion, at least, was that there it was the rich, or those with money, and relatively well-off, who used the judicial review of social economic rights. Now, I know you said I'm talking about Commonwealth countries, and Brazil, maybe you kind of may have something to say about why Brazil is different, but just a kind of a pointer there. And also when you said kind of the big big constitutional cases in Canada, the question is, you know, the big and famous, the ones that get discussed by constitutional lawyers may not actually reflect reality, and many times you see that. And so I have absolutely no idea about this, but the numbers, I think, are more relevant than the ones that get the big discussion. And in fact, judges may have reason to try to downplay those cases which, you know, the cases that they want to get discussed by academics, they will make them longer and more so that they will be trumped as the important cases, whereas those cases that they don't want, they'll kind of write the small, relatively insignificant decision exactly in order to minimize their significance, and then they will be less noticed. Here's a suggestion. So you said I wanted to be more than administrative law. So I'm sort of with you at some level, but maybe
I don't want it to be, but I'm hoping. I think it is.
Okay. So I want to agree with you, like administrative, and I will call it administrative law plus, mm-hmm. which is more than the and sort of based on your building blocks to some extent, but not going all the way. So the administrative law bit of it, which I think is nice, is the fact that you kind of say, I let the legislature set the standards of housing, and I'm not giving courts do the main job of deciding who gets or how much money should be given to housing. But it's plus in the sense that there's some kind of sensitivity to the issue that you raised about giving power to those who are unrepresented. But stopping short of judicial review of legislation, which I admit that in this area I still have issues with, and this leads me to my sort of final point, which is why? Because your solution is ultimately incrementalism, and I admit that at least in my area, which is tort law, which is basically what courts, that's a common law area, there's very little intervention from or relatively little intervention from statutes, and so all you have is kind of incrementalism writ large. And another area perhaps is US constitutional law, where, say, First Amendment, where, again, there's relatively little legislation that drives the development of doctrine there. And I see a mess in both areas. I must say, I'm not. So tortling the common law world, at least from my perspective, is a big mess, and it's pretty much in every area that you care to look at. And American First Amendment, at least as an outsider, is a big mess as well. That decisions kind of fall on different sides on weird. What seemed to me to be weird considerations, and maybe, and this is, I think, a point that Waldron also makes, is one reason may be that judges base their decisions on factors that are, or they give too much weight to factors that they shouldn't, and which is like interpretation of past cases, all kinds of textual formulas and things like this that they get hung up on, because that's how they've been trained, and that they're not necessarily conducive. So they're conducive to incrementalism, but not necessarily conducive to, you know, good policy making.
Okay. So. Thank you very much. There's a lot in there.
Well, there was a lot in your talk.
That's true. That's true. And I'm going to give you a lot more. No, I'm kidding. I'll spare you. On the Brazil, you mentioned Octavio Ferraz's amazing work showing that it has been the economically advantaged who have taken the most cases and showed with, I'd say, flawless empirical methodology that's been the case. Yes, I think Brazil is exceptional. The judge said that the right to health, it guarantees you access to drugs, and scarcity is no excuse. That would never happen in the common law world. They also don't have a doctrine of precedence, so they feel that they can dispense local justice without thinking about the broader implications. It's extremely damaging as a precedent, but I go out of my way in the book to say we should never, ever be doing this. It's true. You say that you can't just take the top 10 cases that liberal law professors thought were the best ones and say that's the picture of the Constitution. It is surprising, though, that those cases mostly concern the interests of criminals. And I think that criminal cases are probably the ones that have the biggest impact overall, because they are legally aided, those cases. They will always throw everything they can to try to reduce reduce the sentence or prevent the chance of being convicted, or even challenge the substance of the criminal law, which the Canadian Supreme Court's Section 7 jurisprudence allows them to do. So you might say, well, maybe there are these sort of nefarious cases that corporations have been taking that haven't been seen. I don't think so. There's an industry of finding those kinds of cases. And
think of how many cases, I just thought about this because of what you just said, how many cases you have in the U.S. Supreme Court on criminal justice and the state of criminal justice in the U.S. So it's
the U.S. Supreme Court is exceptional and dysfunctional. And
no,
that's
why I
said it doesn't apply. So administrative law plus, fair? No problem. I have no problem with that. Although I do think to say that I want to let the legislature set the standards is not the case. The courts would be capable of second-guessing the decision-making process for setting those standards, which is, I guess, tantamount to challenging the standards themselves. Judicial review of legislation, I understand why you have issues about it, and I can't address all of those issues here, but I would say on the First Amendment, you cannot characterize the First Amendment jurisprudence as incrementalist. Citizens United, for instance, is a massive disaster. This is the case that said that your freedom of speech includes the freedom to give as much money as you want to certain political parties. And it's led to a massive shift in campaign financing in the US, like Buckley and Valeo did before it, and a massive increase in funding. And minimalism was a point discussed on the court in that case. Roberts said, well, yes, minimalism's important, but it's not as important as a freedom of expression, so we're not going to do it. So incrementalism was on the table and pushed aside in that case. Textual formalism and the role of precedent. It's true, actually. I have thought about this, and I do think it's a bit weird. We don't want people reasoning about what health requires by giving a lot of weight to something that was done, that was said a while ago. But we also have to respect the rule of law, and I think unless you give weight to precedent, you're not doing that. You're not creating this system of stable expectations. So I think precedent has an important but somewhat limited role, and we know that judges become, I think Lord Denning said, very good at distinguishing. And the textual formalism charge just doesn't fly, I don't think. I mean, that's, if legal realism wouldn't have got anywhere near as far as it did, if that were really true, that they're cabined in by this text. Purposive interpretation is the norm outside the United States. So I think the degree of constriction provided by text and precedent, in other words, are justified by the need to respect the rule of law. Do you want to come back, or?
No,
okay.
Okay. Thank you, Danny. Sean.
Thanks for the
yeah.
So thanks for the presentation, Jeff.
Thank you, Sean.
I think your empirical claims in response to Sonia's question, I think are weak in the Canadian context, and I would say that part of the reason why, if you're looking at the kind of top Supreme Court cases that are important with respect to the Constitution, the main reason why they're criminal law cases is because our legal aid system privileges criminal law cases over all other kinds of cases, and it's basically because based on a gender discrimination, in my view, why do we fund criminal cases and not important family law cases, for example. So I think if you want to make empirical claims about how effective courts have been for marginalized groups, that you would really have to look beyond the Supreme Court cases. You'd have to look at the lower courts and at the pre-court stages. So I've done quite a bit of work on empirical work on the immigration and refugee system, focusing on the administrative tribunal and the first instance federal court level. And the research very clearly shows access to counsel is a, if not the, determinative factor in outcomes. And our legal aid system for refugees is broken and getting worse. So I just think that that you'd want to be more careful with some of your empirical claims. I'm interested, though, in the normative claim. And I'm interested in the idea that you're framing social and economic rights as human rights, as opposed to being rights of citizenship or rights of members of a community. And I'm curious about why you're choosing to go down that route, why we didn't hear language of, you know, the right to housing is a right of citizenship, it's a right of members of the community, as opposed to a human rights. I'd just like to hear kind of why you've done that.
Okay, thank you very much for both of those points. I'll start with the last one. Why have I talked about it in terms of human rights instead of social rights of citizenship? I do, in Chapter 2, distinguish between these. And I think there is a role for social rights of citizenship that may go beyond the minimalism inherent in human rights discourse. So, for instance, we may say that we don't have a human right to a university education, right? Because even in this society, we still less than half of the population will go on to university. It's hard to say that, and they will choose to do that and go on to lead happy and fulfilling lives. It's hard to say that that's a human right. But you might say that in a country like Canada, university education is a social citizenship right. Just like you might say that a certain level of holiday with pay or paternity rights are social citizenship rights. So I acknowledge this category. Why do I not embrace that category? Because there's a character of human rights that says that they are supremely important, and they're supremely important because they outline the minimum conditions for a dignified or autonomous life. And there's something, I think, substantively and rhetorically attractive about that special normative importance. Social citizenship rights, well, they might be important. I'm not sure. Depends on the community. I don't know whether it's better to say, well, you know, in this country we have a right to paternity leave, let's say, whether that has the same kind of, it does the same work as saying we have a human right to shelter in this case. Maybe it does. I don't know why I could be faulted, though, for adopting the language of human rights, because I think it answers the key normative questions about why it's so important to put it in the Constitution, to justify putting it in the Constitution.
Sorry, just to follow up.
Sure.
So it's not a concern about the scope. It's not a concern about people who are not citizens are still entitled to...
It's not, no. Rights. That's not the reason why. In fact, that's not an issue. I have not dealt with the issue of how to deal with the social rights of non-citizens in the book, and neither have I done it in my mind. So you won't have to hear from me on that, fortunately for me. I do say that constitutions can embrace human and social citizenship rights, though. So we're not limited to those that pass the human rights threshold. On the empirical stuff, I don't know what your... I appreciate this comment about looking at lower courts. I've done some of this in the UK, looking at the impact of judicial review on statutory guidance, for instance. And yes, it is an important place to look. I don't know where that objection is going, though. Is it saying, you know, maybe this social rights stuff isn't going to make a big difference because poor won't be able to get there enough? Well, I'll say, as long as it makes a worthwhile difference, I think it's good enough. If you want to say, well, no, because it'll be pernicious in some way, that's a different argument. But I don't buy that it would be. Yeah, even granted that the access will be somewhat uneven, I don't see it. It might not deliver what we would hope for it to deliver, but that's a different claim, and one I'm willing to live with, than the claim that it'll make things worse. Yeah.
Okay.
Sorry, I don't know your name.
My name is Jessica.
Jessica, please.
So what I was reflecting on in terms of another argument that's used in the constitutional context for limiting social rights, or things that we would think of as social rights, are the sort of jurisdictional limitation of the courts in constitutional matters to deal with state action. And when you're talking in sort of general terms about a right to housing or a right to health or a right to subsistence, it seems like these things could exist independent of a particular state program that's being challenged for under-inclusiveness, for example. And I'm wondering if you see those sort of state action limitations as being sort of exploded by the paradigm that you're putting forward, or if they would continue to exist as restraints on the courts when they're dealing with social rights problems.
Okay. Thank you very much, Jessica. Do I think that the emphasis in constitutional adjudication on state action, on already pre-existing state action rather than state omissions, is something that is something I need to fundamentally combat? Is that a fair in my book?
Or just how do you see it fitting into the changes that you're proposing?
Sure. So I think that the distinction between to say that constitutionality only applies to state actions and doesn't impose affirmative duties to do things, I would disagree with that claim. But as a matter of culture, you're right. That's where most of it happens. But doctrinally, even judges have said the Constitution can impose positive obligations. So I don't think there's any formal line in the sand. How would I envisage, though, someone saying, I have a right to X and you have done nothing? How would that work? This is how I think it would work. If the state's done nothing, the court would say, you can't do nothing. You have to do something, because the Constitution guarantees this person a right to health care. So we quashed your decision to do nothing, and you've got to do something. When they've done the something, then they can look at the decision-making process about that. More often than not, in a complex welfare state, they will have done something, and they will have made a decision about all the interests I'm talking about. It's hard to imagine a case where they've literally just done nothing. And so the issue there would be, was the decision-making process related to that decision? Does it comply with the reasonableness that I outlined earlier? So that's how I would see it happening, or hope to see it happening.
Any other questions? Yes.
Your discussion is in the context of the welfare state. And I just have a short question. Would the your ideas, would they operate differently in a non-welfare state, for example? Mm-hmm. Did you give any thoughts to that?
I have, and thank you very much. You know, I assume that you have a welfare state in existence and that there's a good faith political commitment. I actually say a welfare state are the foundations of a welfare state. I think most countries will have the foundations for a welfare state in place, I would hope. The reason I stay clear of those cases is I'm simply not sure what the role of the court would be if there's no welfare state in place. I could envisage there being arguments, but it would depend on a lot. It would depend on the structure of the rest of the politics, depend on, what are some of the most important stresses on such a society? Is ethnic conflict, for instance, a really powerful issue? Are the courts co-opted by the executive branch, for instance? These questions will have different answers, and I think in every of these types of societies that don't have welfare states in place. And that's why I thought a general answer would clearly be outside the scope of this book. I think having said that, though, because of the epistemic limitations of the judiciary, because they can only know within this structure of adjudication where you have a claimant, a respondent, and a judge, there are things in that structure that judges necessarily can't know about. And so some of the stuff that I say about expertise, about polycentricity, are relevant, I think, to judges anywhere. But the stuff on democratic legitimacy isn't, I don't think. Thank you.
Any other questions? Yeah, back to Dan.
Just based on what you said, it's pure speculation, okay? So you may say you have no basis for saying this, but so you said I'm supporting what I'm saying because even if it doesn't get us to utopia, it will give us something, and something is better than nothing. Mm-hmm. I fully agree with you. But here's a potential downside to development, active development, or and perhaps you'll say that's all I'm suggesting, of social and economic rights in the courts, or at least active participation of them, or kind of giving them a central role. Especially if you say social and economic rights are ones that are largely speaking for the benefit of those who are poor or weak, and that was actually a central point of your argument. That may end up being perceived as illegitimate and thereby undermine mm-hmm. the legitimacy of the courts in general, and that's a downside because then the court's work will be undermined not just in that area but also in kind of areas where traditionally or otherwise thought to be fine.
No, that's a really perceptive point. Connor Geraghty made the same point to me at the LSE, and he's very politically savvy. He thought this emphasis on protecting the poor is going to be a very hard sell. And it seems almost perverse to say that one group of people have human rights and that everybody doesn't. Is that what you're mainly concerned about?
Yes. So I'm basically worried about the potential downside, which is exactly political, with regard to the legitimacy of the court's work.
Oh, I see. That the backlash, the public backlash.
Yes.
Okay.
That exactly because they're perceived to be helping those that I suspect many people will think.
Benefits cheats and
exactly.
And leeches, etc.
Exactly.
Well, yes, that's the way the British media portrays what's going on under the Human Rights Act, and that's part of the costs of doing this. And there has been a political backlash against the Human Rights Act, but the question is, does that mean it's worse? I mean, the backlash is to say get rid of the Human Rights Act, and they haven't done it yet. So if your argument is that, well, it's going to make things worse, it depends on saying that the Human Rights Act made things better. I think then the argument can become potentially self-defeating. If you view the Charter or the Human Rights Act as progress and taking it away as regress, then I don't see how you're any worse off with having the Charter. But there's a way in which this anti-poor stuff might leach into other areas. I don't know. It's a risk. I'd be concerned about it. It's a risk with all constitutional rights adjudication. I don't think the evidence of that has been extremely strong. I don't think the evidence that it's worse than the status quo ante of having no Bill of Rights is very strong. I'd be vigilant about it, though.
Okay, so we're almost at 2, so I'm going to close it there. My thanks to all of you for attending and for a great set of questions, and thanks as well to Jeff for a very thought-provoking talk.
Thank you very much. Thank you.